a beautiful day to be in God's house. Amen?
Amen.
Amen, amen. It's always a beautiful day because it's the day that the Lord has made. Men, or excuse me, husbands specifically. This is my chance and my opportunity to remind you that we are now in February. That means something. That definitely means something. So make sure that you plan accordingly. I'll give you one more warning next Sunday. That's all I can help you with. But Valentine's Day is quickly approaching, so plan appropriately. All right, we are so glad and thankful you came to join us for worship today. We want to, of course, start off this service with prayer and ask the Lord to be in it and through it and fill this place with His presence. So please join me as we open the prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You for this beautiful day that You've given us. And we know and confess that it is a day that You have made. And Father, we come today not as perfect children, but as children who love their Heavenly Father. And I pray that as we lift up our voices today to sing and to worship You, it would be a sweet fragrance unto You. Father, fill this place with Your presence and remind us of Your grace, Your mercy, and Your love that is renewed day by day for us. Father, thank You that You love us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's stand and worship this morning.
Just because. PM, we will take a look at a very important subject. Deacon, next Sunday, we will be on following our worship and no details. On Wednesday, February 14th, we will be on their Valentine's Day services. Senior Bill Potter, former Spartan Post, will be here at 11:00 today.
Thank you.
Thank you for this opportunity to come, Lord, to gather without fear, without persecution. And yet there's so many brothers and sisters around the world constantly face trials and tribulations, persecution, Lord, that you can only imagine. Pray, Father, that you be with us around the world. And we thank you, Lord, that you do be for us. Father, I pray, help us tonight. Speak to us from your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. In this entire book, 1 John, we find the word know, not N-O, K-N-O-W, know something. We find the word know over 32 times. And just in this chapter, chapter 5 alone, we find it 8 times. Now we're not going to go over all of them, but here's a sampling of the things that John tells us that we can know. He says we can know God, chapter 2, verse 3. This is how we are sure that we have come to know Him, by keeping His commandments. We can also know that we are in God. Chapter 2, verse 5. Just a couple of verses down. But whoever keeps His word, truly in Him, the love of God is perfected. This is how we know we are in Him. So we can know that we know God, and we can know that we are in God. We can also know that Jesus came to take away our sins. Chapter 3, verse 5. You know that He was revealed so that you might so that He might take away sins. And there is no sin in Him. We also can know love. Chapter 3, verse 16. He said, this is how we have come to know love, that He laid down His life for us. We should also lay down our lives for our brothers. We can also know the spirit of truth and the spirit of deception. Chapter 4, verse 6. We are from God. Anyone who knows God listens to us. Anyone who is not from God does not listen to us. From this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of deception. We can also know, as we just read this morning, that we have eternal life. 55 verse 13. We have written these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know we have eternal life. We can also know that we belong to God. Chapter 5, verse 19. We know that we are of God. The whole world is under the sway. We can know the truth of God. Everything, that's not everything that John has said in this short book that we could know. Clearly, he was concerned that we understand and that we stand on the truth, that we do not waver, that we do not have two minds, that we do not doubt. So I want to bring up a question this morning. What do we do with doubts? I heard a very wise and godly pastor share a story once. After he was done preaching a sermon on doubt, he was down and reading people as they looked at him, and one gentleman very confidently grabbed his hand and shook the preacher's hand, and he said, with his head held high, I want you to know that I've never had a serious doubt in my life. The pastor very wisely and quickly said, well, then you must have never had any serious thoughts. Doubt is something that everyone, all of us, at one time or another, have struggled with. It is not something uncommon. Let's just take a poll real quick. How many of you have ever had doubt? How many of you have ever had a doubt about your salvation? Now Satan wants you to believe that that's a lie and that you are the only one. He also wants you to believe that if you doubt, that means you're not really saved. So you better not doubt. And there's this fear that we have of doubt. Now, is it wrong to doubt? It's not a good thing. But it is a tool that Satan uses against us. Satan wants us to have doubts. He wants us to lack confidence in God and in His Word and in His will. Go all the way back to prayer. Back to the Lord. We know that Satan lied to have doubts. But he lied to sow seeds of doubt in their minds. And when those seeds bloom, the result is this. When we come to a fork in the road, if we know which way is correct, we take the right. But if you come to a fork in a road and you're not sure and you have doubt, chances are you're going to probably take the one that looks a little nicer, where the road's a little smoother, where the grass is a little greener. You make it the one you want. Satan wants to sow seeds of doubt in us so that we will disobey the Lord. But Satan can't stop us from believing in Jesus. He can do everything he can to stop us from trusting. Not walk alive. Everyone has doubt in their life. The truth is, none of us have believed in all. And if you do, you're a liar. Now, real quick. Would anybody here say their faith is stronger than John the Baptist? Good. No one raised their hand. It's like, half expected a child to raise their hand. I think all of us know who John the Baptist is in the Gospels, and we know that he was a great man of faith. And we would not say, yes, I have more faith than John the Baptist. We know that John the Baptist had doubt. Let's look. Matthew chapter 11. Turn with me, if you will. Keep your finger, of course, in 1 John. We're going to turn it back there. But Matthew chapter 11. Start with verse 1. When Jesus had finished giving orders to his 12 disciples, he moved on from there to teach and to preach in their towns. When John heard in prison, John the Baptist was in prison, when John heard in prison what the Messiah was doing, he sent a messenger by his disciples and asked him, "Are you the one who is to come? Or should we expect someone else?" So John was not certain whether or not Jesus was the Messiah. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 3. We'll start with verse 13. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan, baptized by him. But John tried to stop him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and yet you come to me." Jesus answered, "Allow it for now, because this is the way for us to fulfill all righteousness." And then he allowed him to be baptized. After Jesus was baptized, he went up immediately from the water. The heavens suddenly opened for him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming down on him. And there came a voice from heaven saying, "This is my Son, my beloved Son, whom I well please." That was John the Baptist, who was right there, who baptized Jesus in the Jordan, and then saw that and heard that voice. Now fast forward, John is in prison. Probably not his favorite place to be, probably not a place any of us want to be. And John is getting these reports of these things that Jesus is doing, that he's going about, and that he is teaching, and that he is preaching. And John begins to wonder, am I doing wrong? Is he the one that's supposed to come? He never doubted God. He never doubted the Messiah was coming. But he doubted for a moment whether or not Jesus was the Son of God, whether he was the Messiah to come. So he sent his disciples to ask Jesus, "Are you the Christ?" Jesus replied, chapter 11, verse 1, "Go and report to John what you see. Blind see, lame walk, those with skin diseases are healed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor are told the good news. If anyone is not offended and touched me,
doubt is that we haven't done something right.
our clear thinking, we haven't done something right, that means our faith, of course, is not in the completed works of Christ on the cross, it's in our own beliefs. There's a faulty thinking there, which again, is edified by Christ, by the Word of God. Christ has done everything. And you can know whether or not you are saved. Now this verse does imply that it's entirely possible to be saved and yet not have that assurance. If that man truly put his faith and his trust in Jesus Christ as his Lord and his Savior, but he has succumbed to the doubt that Satan has sowed in his life, it doesn't take away his salvation. It does take away his peace. It does take away his security. So you can be a Christian. You can be saved this morning and yet not have assurance. But what a way to live. And let me just tell you this morning, it's a beautiful thing to stand on this promise. John was telling his readers, this is why I wrote this book, so that you may know that you have eternal life. Not so you will have eternal life. That's a different book. Turn to John, the Gospel. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. One thing John was very good about, he's good about putting purpose statements in his writing. Ever talk to someone or ever read a letter or an email, and as you're reading, you're like, okay, what's the point here? I don't understand what you're asking. John is very good about telling us exactly what he wrote for. John chapter 30, chapter 20, verse 30. A little dyslexic there. Apologize. John chapter 20, verse 30. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of disciples that are not written in this book. But these were written so that, here's the purpose statement, so that you may believe Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and by believing you may have life in His name. John very clearly wrote the Gospel of John so that people who did not believe would come to believe and have life. Now, 1 John is written to believers, not unbelievers, to believers, people who are saved, who know Christ. I've written these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God. So he's writing to his brothers and sisters in Christ. And he says, so that you may know. Having assurance is critical for our spiritual health and our growth. J.C. Ryle put it this way. He says, faith is the root, assurance is God. You cannot have the flower without the root. Because we have faith in the name of God's Son, Jesus Christ, as our Lord and Savior, we can have assurance that we have. Very quickly, I'm going to jump into this. We talked about it the very first Sunday. We jumped into John chapter 5. John gives us markers. He gives us signs in our life. Please be reading this chapter several times. But there's three signs that we see in this book, especially in chapter 2, and especially in this first part of chapter 5, when we looked at a couple Sundays ago. There's three markers that he gives us that we can know. These are signs in our life that we There's a theological marker, there's a moral marker, and there's a social marker. The theological marker is who we believe Jesus is. There's many people who profess to know Jesus, yet the Jesus they say they believe in is not the Jesus of this Bible. There are religions out there that believe that Jesus was one of the many sons. Or there's the people out there who believe that Jesus was not born divinely, but that divinity was placed upon him as the fact that he was not eternally God. There are people that believe that Jesus was an angel, a messenger, just a preacher, just a prophet. There's people who believe all kinds of things about Jesus. The theological marker of someone who's truly saved is if you believe Jesus of the Bible, that he is God's one and only Son, eternally existence, and lived a sinless and perfect life. And then John, over and over again throughout the book, gives us a moral marker. If we say we believe in him, we will walk as a prophet. If we do serve God as that, we obey his command, follow his command, live by Christ. Now again, these are not things that we do so we are saved. You don't do these things and then you're saved. Because you're saved, these are markers you seek. So there's the theological marker, the moral marker, obeying and walking in obedience to the Lord, and then the social marker, which is love with one another. Of course, Jesus said, how will the world know that we are his disciples? Let's try that again. Come on, guys. And it's February. It's the month of love. Yeah. Jesus said the world would know his disciples by how we love one another. Exactly. How we love. So these are markers that we see in our life. Theological markers, moral markers, and social markers. And we don't take from each one. It's a package deal. When you look at your life, and you know and you profess that Jesus is the Son of God, that he lived a perfect sinless life, that he died on the cross for your sins, that he was buried and raised to life 3 days later, when you walk according to his law and his commands, not perfectly, because none of us are Christ, none of us are going to live a sinless life. But you get back up and you continue to trust in him, you continue to follow him, you repent of the sins in your life, you love those around you. You love the brothers and sisters in Christ, and not perfectly. When you look at those things combined, you can see that, yes, you are on the narrow path. You are a child of God. You are little God. You can have assurance this morning. You can know without a shadow of a doubt that you have eternal life. Second thing that we have, according to this passage, that gives us strength when we have doubts, is that we have confidence. Verse 14. Now this is the confidence we have before him. This confidence is directly tied to the previous verse. Verse 13 and 14 are not separate, but joined together. The reason that we have confidence is because of who we are in him. Because we have eternal life. Because we are a child of God. Our identity in him gives us strength and courage to stand in truth. And he says we have confidence before him. We're back in more medieval times, or we're back in empire and kings and queens and that such. An emperor or a pharaoh or a king could execute anybody they wanted to without any reason. And many times, one of the things that they might do is if you came on the life, or it might be that if you just happen to be the short man on the totem pole, you drew the short stick, you had to go deliver the bad news to the king. And kings didn't like getting bad news. And oftentimes, whoever brought the bad news would suffer in ill fate. And so there's always this fear of coming before the ruler. He didn't know how they would respond. But we can have confidence when we come before the Lord and we approach his throne, and we can lay our requests at his feet. As Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 12, speaking later back into verse 11. This is according to the purpose of the ages which he made in the Messiah, Jesus our Lord. So this is who he's speaking of. In whom we have boldness, access, and confidence through faith in him. Because of your relationship with Christ, because of who you are in him, we have access. We have confidence. We can boldly approach the throne of God. Notice, I do not mean without reverence or respect. The Bible is very clear that you should approach the Lord in fear, a healthy fear. The same kind of fear we would have of our parents. My kids, they don't fear me. They have a healthy fear of the consequences. We have confidence because of who we are in Christ. Come before the Lord. Hebrews chapter 4, chapter 4, verse 14 and 16. It says this, therefore, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to the confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who has been tested in every way as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us at the proper time. We have confidence to come before the Lord, lay our requests at his feet. And we can have confidence that he hears us. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 29. The Lord is far from the wicked, but he hears the prayer of the righteous. 1 John chapter 5, verse 14. This is the confidence we have before him. Whatever we ask, we pray to his will. Confidence in our request, confidence that he will do this. Thirdly, verse 15. God says, we know that he hears whatever we ask. We know we have what we ask for. Now, this does not mean that prayer is like a magic lamp that you rub and then a genie. God pops out, what can I grant for you? What's your wish? It's not what this verse is saying. And prayer is not like a vending machine. You go up to the vending machine, you put in your prayers, and you wait for the thing that you ask for to drop down out of the sky. That's not what this is saying. Don't miss these vital words that it said in verse 14. Now this is the confidence we have before him, whatever we ask. Whenever we ask anything according to whose will? His will. We can have confidence that he hears us, but we can also have confidence that he answers us. We need to pray. John and James. Brother, he's writing, he mentions this, James chapter 4, verse 3. He says, you ask and don't receive. Why? Because you ask wrongly, so that you may spend it on your desire. How many times have I prayed, and I've prayed selfish prayers? How many times have I prayed things that I have prayed? How can you regard that the Lord is? Now, it's okay to share with the Lord your desires. It's okay to share with the Lord your thoughts. And it's okay to share with the Lord your hopes. But understand that we should always end our prayers with, according to your will. If it's your will. Because I've sat there beside a bed before and prayed that someone would be healed. Pray that they would feel better. Pray that they would miraculously overcome this illness or disease that they have. But I always pray, Lord, if that is your will, yes. Because we might want that person to stay and live with us as long as we are alive. We might want that person to get better and not to hurt anymore. But that might not be the plan that God has. It might be that He is calling that person home. And that's a hard thing to accept. But let me share this with you. We need to understand that when God calls us home, we're doing so much better than we are. Paul said, it would be far better for me to be with the Lord in heaven, but I know that He wants me to still be here with you. Life is hard. Life is difficult. There are many things that happen in our life where we begin to doubt. God gives us a beautiful promise. We are present. I'm sorry. You don't have to live in doubt. Take them to the Lord. Just in this short little passage, not at all encapsulating everything you have. You can find that. You have assurance. You know who we are in Christ Jesus. We can find that. We can have confidence. We can come to the Lord in who we trust. We can find out that we know God. Faith overcomes doubt. God doesn't want you to live with two minds. He doesn't want you to waver back and forth between believing and unbelieving, between belief and disbelief. God wants you to know that you can trust Him, that you can stand on the truth of His Word. You can come to Him with anything. It's my hope that everyone who is here this morning, that knows Christ Jesus as their Lord and Savior, to walk out that door knowing that you have eternal life. What a difference that makes. Stand up for speed. Don't let Satan rob you. Don't let him rob you of your confidence, your strength, your joy. Stand in God's Word. Please stand if you will. If you'd like to pray, the altar's open. If there's some doubt you'd like to come and lay at His feet, you may. If you'd like for me to pray with you, I'd love to. If God's calling you to a different decision, then you have the faith to step out. Trust Him. As He calls, will you come?
Oh,
Amen, amen. Come back and join us tonight for our very important topic, church membership. Please remember all the other announcements that are in your bulletin. If you are on the long-range planning team, and also if you are a deacon or on the church council, please stay right after service and go meet with all of those groups. Let's grab a hand across the aisle and we'll be dismissed this morning.